I want to introduce Maureen, who is the director of the Sonoy Historical Society. And she's going to introduce somebody that probably doesn't need any introductions. But it's yours.
Okay, thank you. I'm happy to be joining you here tonight, and I bring greetings from all of us at the Sonoy Area Historical Society, along with an invitation to visit us any Friday or Saturday between 1 and 4. We're open. So, our mission is to preserve and promote Sonoy's history, and it is accomplished through fundraising, donations, and membership. These efforts provide us with the means to run our history museum, and our history museum tells Sonoy's history. But tonight, there's another story to tell. It is with great pleasure that I introduce Sonoy's living legend and successful businessman, Mr. Ellis Crook. To know Ellis is to love him. He has touched so many lives in a positive and generous way, his latest beneficiary being the Sonoy Area Historical Society. Thanks to Ellis, the book proceeds from Sonoy Boy are being donated to the Sonoy Area Historical Society. A generous gesture, to be sure. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Mr. Ellis Crook.
If you want a microphone.
Yes.
If you want it, there it is.
Thank you. Well, ladies, I see right now somebody put the word out there's a crook on speaking about. Nobody's coming, but I say right quick. It just slipped up already by telling everybody there's a crook coming. But anyway, I'm 89 years old. I'm proud to just to be here to enjoy life every day. I'm a Korean veteran from 1952 to 1954. I have seen a lot of changes in this old world. Tonight, there's three types of speech. One's a memorized, one's a written, one's an extemporaneous. I'm gonna give you a combo, extemporaneous and written. But I can't even do that memorized, it's too late for me. But anyway, I wanna recognize my daughter Cheryl Crook Thompson to your left now. Jim Scott back there is worst half of this part right now. Maureen has done a wonderful job in Sonoma. I mean a fantastic job. That's the reason I did what I've done, because she has promoted that society down there. It's fantastic, I mean, what she's done. And I'm proud to be a part of it and enjoy what they're doing. Now, at 89 years old, I might have Alzheimer's, I might have dementia, but you'll find out tonight. I'm not running for the Senate, I'm running for the president. You don't heard that lately? But anyway, Mike.
Where were you last week?
Okay,
last month.
That's right. Anyway, I have great heritage. My great grandfather was buried a few miles out from Sonoy for the Civil War and got wounded. When he got out of the hospital, they put him in a different regiment than what he was with. He went AWOL. Went back and joined his old regiment, so he could fight with his old regiment. Thank goodness he made it back to Sonoy. So we go way back to roots in Sonoy, Georgia, my people do. But Daniel Morgan fought at the Battle of Cowpen, South Carolina, defeated the British General Territory way back years ago. It's a national park there at Cowpen, South Carolina, about this particular battle. Now, I'm coming on the Morgan side, I come in again. My grandmother was Morgan, and Zeke Morgan and another Morgan buried right there in Sonoma, the Sundays. So you talk about history way back, a long time ago. But enough of that. I served on the zoning. I helped set up the zoning appeals board in 1970s in Coweta County zoning appeals board. I served on that several years that until I built a supermarket in 1981. Meanwhile, I served 41 years, okay, to get a hospital authority. and I'm one of the guys assigned to sell Cage Hill Hospital for several reasons. One, to get all the taxpayers right book every year. And number two, to break the dynasty of three surgeons, bring more surgeons in, because the other doctors, GP, had depended on those three surgeons. They had enough of them to get something done, to get the operation done. So we brought it, we sold the hospital in the green building, almost building next door to the hospital, with Humana, we sold Humana. So that's another one of the things I've been highly involved in. Cuyahoga County Hospital, after we sold the hospital, we had quite a bit of money sitting invested. And we gave a chunk of money, the hospital authority did, to two things. One was a Good Samaritan Clinic, which was set up on the highway 29 north of here and there. It's a great woman, I can't call her name right now. She heads that, head that up and got it going.
Kane.
She had
that
clinic. What's her name?
Kane Crosby.
Kane
Crosby.
That's it. She was a great woman. Another chunk of money we gave was to start the nursing school, West Georgia, trained nurses for the health institute. Health reasons. So I've been around quite a while. Anyway, let me get my notes. I've served on part of, don't get this way. I did not intend to write a book. I started, I was typist from way back. I was typist in the Army. And I have an office at my finance company. Across the street, office there. And as I go by the typewriter over the years, I type something that hit my mind, you know. So it kept piling up. So I hit 8 or 9 years old, I told my daughter, Cheryl. I said, Cheryl, we got to do something. I hate to throw it away. So I took it to her. She scanned it into the computer, took one look at it, said, Dad, it's too much for me. I ain't got time for this. So she came with the idea of getting Angela McRae, a professor right from New York Times Herald for years, to take it on as a project, a paid project, to get it all lined up and set up right. And she did a wonderful job of a compilation of all the facts and figures and putting everything in order with readable and enjoyable, I think, to most people. But anyway, that's the way this book started off. That's how it became. On top of that, Arthur Samuel said my husband Dennis is president of Southwest Arkansas. And Dennis and Cheryl, and my late friend Nancy Lewis, and I don't know how many old Hal Sewell, he's my nephew. He spoke years ago, Roscoe years ago, his grandparents did. Anyway, Hal, they all read my book, edited. Everybody had to get in on it. And they took out some things I said. They said, I couldn't say that. So anyway, I was talking about too much already. Anyway, I have to use them good at that. But anyway, the time they got through editing and all, Dennis got it published to print it. It cost me $5,000 to get all this done, including 200 books. And I know I've been a book signer, I know what it's all about. But thank goodness I had people guiding me. That night at book signing, we sold 160 books that night. And sold the rest of them on the weekend, about 200 books. Now we're somewhere between 600 and 700 books sold. Hey, I sold out this past weekend in a store. My son keeps order on Amazon. So we had 50 more coming in today, books. And I'm proud to say that I got somebody either I love to read or a fool to one. Anyway, I've enjoyed all this time doing that. Let me go back to history now. I grew up pretty poor. Not poor, but poor. Back in, I was born in 31 during the Depression. And my daddy started in business in 1913 as a young man, about 25 years old. They had one store in town, a shotgun store in town, had another on railroad track between Snow and Griffin, what they called Chesler's. A Chesler's was a brick pits where they dug brick. That's all it was there. It was black man dug red mud made bricks. They were about a mile out of store and went to a Griffin. Anyway, you'll read about in the book about him hauling a prisoner back on his buggy, prisoner getting loose. You'll read about that in the book. You'll read about the ghost, even being on top of Porter Hill, coming out between halfway between Stars Mill and Sloy, about the ghost he had. You'll read that in the book about what happened. Wait till he's pissing down and see what he came into with that ghost. You'll read about that in the book. On top of that, back to my age, when I was born, we was living on a farm, farming, and at 6 years of age, you'll see my picture on the front of the book. The 6 years of age with a cotton sack on it, and a cotton field, at the edge of a cotton field. So that was around 36, 37 probably. Anyway, I was number five of my brother, my one sister and four brothers. I mean, four were boys. They all left home when I was 6 years old, and I caught the ill accent from then on. Because I started working there. I was 9 years old. I was planting cotton with a new cotton plant where I live today. And I can say I stand on my property there and look across the road, down the road right there, tens of way where the Snow Airport is. That's where I was born. I have the great privilege of living in Snow all my life, except the time Uncle Sam drove me out of there, 2 years Uncle Sam. But other than that, I've had a great life there. But anyway, when I was 9 years old, I also thought it was a great thing that I was a black guy named, we call him Preacher Murray, built a cow. And Preacher Murray was smarter than I was. Preacher Murray taught me how to get a cow. Well, lo and behold, there was a reason for it. My daddy wanted him me to learn how, so he wouldn't have to pay me. He paid the Preacher Murray. I didn't have to pay me to pretty better cow. So I started milking cows at 9 years of age, every morning, every night. And I also a story in the book about how I could take a 10 on a cow, square in the mouth, with sitting over there on my pitch looking at me, you know. You hit him when you squeeze. And another thing, a cow never had four tits on it. You take his finger right here, put between them, he pull out all four at one time. He's got a good strength. He put all four at one time, every cow. But anyway, also, you had to hold the bucket. You set the bucket on the bottom of the floor underneath the cow, you'd like putting that foot up and put some manure in that bucket. Well, you have to be milk. You did that, you had to take the ice straight two or three times. But other than that, you learn how to hold the bucket between your legs where the cow wouldn't put the foot in the bucket. You learned that the hard way. So anyway, I thought I was a cowboy one time. But they're tied two milk cows had horns on them, two horns. I was gonna play cowboy. So I took a rope, tied two cows together around the horns. Somehow they took off down through the pasture there. And just as they got to this big pine tree, one of them jerked the other child into the pine tree and blew one of the horns off. By God, I caught hell for that, I'll tell you that right now. My daddy. But got to run the sale of a good milk cow. But by the way, back in those days, way back before that time, you have all kind of clubs now. How many ever heard of a beef club? Any of you ever heard of a beef club?
Mm-hmm.
You heard of all kind of clubs, right? But not a beef club. You know what a beef club is?
No, sir.
A beef club is what four people, each one get a calf, and they raise that calf up to slaughtering age. And you do your kill them at one time, well, you kill it sometimes, you can work it sometime. But when you kill it, you kill one of the four get a front quarter. The other gets a back quarter. And the other gets a front quarter, the other gets a back quarter. So they buy that calf up right, the cow right up there between them. They each get one fourth of the cow. That's called, it being at a beef club, they call it. That's called refrigeration one, so when that big one. Refrigeration and eating that back in those days. That's a long time ago. That's called beef club, back way back. Anyway, I live right across the road where they used to call Boneyard Woods. And that's where they kick cows and kill them. And back in the butcher day, way back, a fellow time, Tom Cook had a store at the time where he butchered them and cut them apart. But you kill them that day, you're going to sell them out that day. And that reminded me to tell you about the time during World War II going on. You had a bread man bring bread down out of the mountain. Well, he hauled more on that truck than bread. He hauled anything he get his hands on World War II going on. And we had a little store sitting with the back of Sonoma, says that, was back in Coweta. We had a little store sitting there. My dad was renting. Anyway, that bread man brought down whiting fish in a 10-pound box on Saturday morning, frozen when left alive. We have some out that day when they thought for it wouldn't. They ain't too bad because we didn't have any refrigerated frozen facilities at all. All we had was a water box that had cold water, cocoa as I call them, and a ice cream box, all we had, and a pair of baby scales to weigh stuff on. That was it. And during World War II going on, you could sell anything that you get your hands on. And strigling meat was a good example. You got back in those days, you've heard of strigling meat, sliced strigling meat, like bacon. You call it bacon now, because raw meat is called strigling meat. Anyway, you get a slab in, and you can't get about one slab, probably, it's ration. And my dad would take and cut it in a square, other squares, and take a newspaper and tie a string around it. Put it on the counter, hide it. Because you had women that have nothing to do, come out and buy up anything scarce, he had his customers out there working all day that he thought a lot of and did business with them all the time. He would hide it on the counter and save it for them so they could get it. Another good story about Coca-Cola. Now, you would like to get one case of Coca-Cola. The two would be fantastic a week. So we had a little ice house out there beside the store. They had blocks of ice in it. My job was to get those Coca-Cola and hide behind the ice box and behind the ice. Well, we had a Baptist preacher wife come down there. We're looking at a woman, too. She put the make on my dad to get a Coca-Cola. And she was pretty good at adapting to do that. But meanwhile, I was going with one of the daughters, so I couldn't say much, you know what I mean? So here we go. But anyway, that goes way back a long time ago right there. Anyway, back to that store, a guy ran that store out from under my dad, or ran out from my daddy. He's going to pay a cent and a half a gallon. And my dad said, I'll pay it too. They went out. Light got in a fight over there, they're going to throw him out. So anyway, J.D. Hudson, who you've heard of Jimmy Hudson, surely some of you around here, Jimmy had a hardware store in Sonoma. His daddy sold my daddy the corner right down Broad Street in 16, 100 by 100 for $400 and a contract handshake. Back in those days, they had a lawyer. Now you had two or three lawyers draw a contract. But back then, it was a handshake contract between the two people. Then we keep selling gasoline that from Mr. J.B., who was a stripper. So sometime along about then, I was 19 years old probably. I was buying cars off the auction block at Bishop Brothers in Atlanta. 19 years old trying to sell them. And I went up to Mr. Bobwell, friend of the bank. He was an old man bank up there. Mr. Bobwell, I saved these two notes for these cars I sold. Got to save these two notes. So Mr. Bobwell looked at me and looked at the notes. He said, well, I'll take on a recourse. Well, you know what? That sounded great to me. He said, I want to get my money. But I found out one valuable hard lesson I learned. I learned what the word recourse meant. They didn't pay for the car. They didn't pay on the notes. And Mr. Bobwell called me up there and told me about it. And you talking about a poor scuffle that paid over 2 months off. I had a scuffle. So I learned what the word recourse meant right quick. Back in 19, somewhere along about 19 years old again, my dad contacted tuberculosis. And he was in there 2 years with tuberculosis. And that's the only thing I say, that saved me really, because I was 19 years old running a gas station, a grocery convenience store. Learned some hard lessons too long then. But I was able to survive it. I took money home at night, and it wasn't that much to take home, really. And a cigarette box wasn't on my dad's bed. He counted it, empty the joy, counted up money that night. But they didn't want to pick a cigarette box for me. Go back to the store, work the store that day. But along about that time, the Standard Oil people who was selling Mr. J.B., he was a stripper for a Standard Oil company. to the dealership away from him is going to be distributed out of Newnan shortly. So he's going to lose the distributorship. But Mr. J.B. went to Gulf and got signed up with Gulf to get a distributorship in Sonoma. So he didn't call, he didn't come down and see me and told me what happened. So Mr. J.B., I got in the car, Mr. J.B. went downtown around to Sonoma headquarters. I walked down like I thought I was the biggest wheel in the world. I told the gentleman, I'm 19 years old. I'm operating this gas station, so with your product on it, your equipment on it. And I want to get your equipment off. I'm going to Mr. J.B., we're going to Gulf. So we buffaloed that deal right quick, got it done for Mr. J.B. So that was a double experience when I was 19 years old. I accomplished. But anyway, we rock along, and I got drafted in 1952. And that was 2 years at Fort Jackson, South Carolina. And when I was there, we got through basic training. I bumped into a guy that I went to school with in Atlanta. He said, I was on the horse called Korea too. They were fighting like hell by then. And I was on the horse called Korea. He said, you want to stay in? He said, she's damn right, I do. He said, can you type? I said, I'm a good typist. So he put me in. They don't say anything at all, so I just sit still. Next thing I know, I got orders coming down to send me the regimental personnel typing up all the records. And that saved me. And I paid it back in full. I got his brother sent to Fort Mac because I was in personnel at Fort Mac. But I had a decent good time at dating girls in Columbia, South Carolina. I don't know what's going on, though. But anyway, I came back home at the end of the work, well, at the end that time. And I walked down that little store my dad had. I see the dad walked in. The meat cutter, Mr. Blatt, was standing back there in the meat cage with a foot propped over the end of the meat cage looking out the door. A black man named Joe Watson was propped on a drink box up front looking out the window. And that's 7 days in with a chair. What am I coming back to? What am I going to do? But I was lucky enough that I worked for him and went, they paid me very little too. I went to Georgia, what they call Georgia State, and back then it was a violent division of the University of Georgia. And I went there for until I had gone to Southern Business University right out of high school 1 year. That was a Crook, or that was a Crook school. But anyway, I went to Georgia and like stayed there for mechanics and so forth. Anyway, somehow my brother came and told my dad he was selling out to me on credit. And he sold to me on January credit, and I got married in July, and paid him back every week. But this book is it's got quite a bit of things right there about old Sonoma.
Let me interrupt for just a second.
Huh?
Tell them about going to college and how Dr. Tribble helps you go to college.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, I'm trying
this
to
go. It's not in the book, by the way.
You go to Georgia State now. I try working all day and going to leave about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, about 4 and go to be up at 5, college. I couldn't just stay awake to get home. Well, I swapped the car on top of the hill. I come into town, one night, swapped side road to call. We swapped sides. But anyway, Dr. Tribble gave me Dexedrine. They get a doctor to do that now. Give you Dexedrine, keep you awake. Bug your eyes wide open, class. You couldn't get one to do that for you now, the way in the world. Oh yeah, Dr. Tribble. He had always right there on Main Street, and don't always stay open. And I'm gonna go up there and get a shot of penicillin. He said, drop your drawers, bend over. And damn, doors stand right open. He shoots a drug up and said, everybody can walk by, see your moonshine all over. He didn't care. He's a good old man. I love him. I love him to death. And he and I and M.H. Ella were the only three from Snowy that belonged to Elstub and Inventory. Now, Dr. Trillman, he belonged because you pick up his spirit bottles of spirits out there, take back to Snowy. Now, I did things, of course, M.A. the only way they went or not. But I enjoyed. Back when I'll tell them the other night about the one-armed bandits we had in Newnan. We were back at the Veterans Club and at the Moose Club. The gambling machines. Mother didn't know what a one-armed bandit was long ago. It's a gambling machine. But anyway, I tell Martha one time that the club in Newnan, someone broke in one night, loaded all the machines up from the Veterans Club. They got a call the next day, you want your machines back? Sure. Told them how much money to get, how much money to bring with them. have one person come in a band, one person by the set. When you get a certain point, Rome, Georgia, call us number. And they had to go to the woods up there. I pay a machine to bring back some inventory. But the mice of the gamma machine with the Atlanta newspaper, they got on the subject about this gamma machine down there. And the sheriff had to make a pull of the gamma machine. So it used to be a live place. The name of being in the gamma machine, and I'd be dancing with late day wives out there and they bought them that way back years ago. You know, a lot of divorces were caused by that too. Too much squeezing going on. You don't want to be the wrong people, you know, sometimes. But you've all seen that. You all know what I'm talking about. But anyway, go back to milking cows. I paddle buttermilk for 5 cents a quart. See what a quart of buttermilk cost you now? $1.61, $1.75. But I paddle buttermilk for a nickel quart. And I met this old lady I paddled to. She poured that buttermilk out, put a little bit of water in that jar, and slushing around to get all that buttermilk out. She wanted a nickel quart. She wanted to get all out of that jar. And I took that money and paid for music lessons, piano lessons. And I was able to, you ever heard a song, Beulah Lamb, in church? I could knock it out. I could knock it out. But I got married and didn't have a piano in my house. And had to start playing the Jewish piano. You know what a Jewish piano is? In a cash register. That was a Jewish piano. I had to start playing the Jewish piano. So I lost my talent. But I have a lovely lady I go with now. She's a music teacher. And she teaches music, and she dances real well, too. But anyway, back to milking cows and so forth. Anyway, the time, another thing is, let me flip on here. I don't want to miss too much here. I'm not used to using all these notes. But I told you we written and spoken. In 1960, anyway, it's been a journey, a real journey. I was lucky I was born like where I was the day I was. We've enjoyed a wonderful area in all these years. It's going to change one day. And it took about 2 months what's going to happen. In my book, on the fourth page of my book is written by Hal Sewell. Now Hal Sewell had an uncle named J.P. Sewell, was Secretary of Treasury of the Union Federal Savings alone. And he had another uncle, Hal Sewell, they grew up all out in Roscoe. And he wrote the foreword for this book. I should have really set him up, he'd give me a lot too. He'd build me up too high. I didn't pay him off either.
And by the way, for those in the room who don't know, that's Hal's sister right there. Elaine.
He's my baby brother.
That's right.
Elaine Sewell, right there. Anyway, he's a great guy. He's a Sewell all the way because he's a musician. He doesn't have a drop of Crook blood in his body. But he's a musician and he does a wonderful job at the church and small joint at the church for music. But I go back to the book took a long time. Oh, you're killing hogs. You read about my book, How to Kill a Hog. Where you shoot them at, where you cut them at, where you ain't processing. It's in the book. You read the book. And anyway, that's quite a while ago I had to do that. But it was one of the main things. Anyway, there were World War II going on. We had OPA, Office of Price Stabilization. You had to have coupons to buy gasoline. Ration keeping. And if you're ration keeping, it would be 5 gallons for 90 cents. Now, if you didn't have a ration keeping, you buy a bootleg keeper, you'd be paying 50 cents a gallon for that back in those days. And I did ration. And tires, you couldn't get a top of their tire. My daddy bought a pickup truck, a used pickup truck, so he came out and knew it. So you take the tires off it and put on the car to go to church. Car and go to church somewhere. And take them off, and then haul something, take them off that car and put them back on the truck and haul something. That's how bad things were in World War II. Wow. I mean, they were tough. And so the rations are tough. But people don't realize how fortunate we are now to be able to live in the world we live in. The availability of product you have at your fingertips. and our stores like they have now. They've been having another day for all. But anyway, the let me get on down to you. I had an uncle that mixed a formula for Coca-Cola around 1920. Back then, Coca-Cola had a little copper vat down in the basement in Atlanta. That's where they mixed the formula. When he took the job, walked in, took the job, he caught that green, you know, copper can turn green. He cleaned the copper vat up, and back in those days, they probably got cocaine and real stuff in it back in those days. Anyway, one day this guy walked in a white shirt and started in that. Michael stopped him, lazy camera. Came in, he said, I lied about it. Then lazy camera patted him on the back, thanked him well for protecting that formula. And till the day he died, they looked at him lawyer because he had a formula in his head. He remember had a formula in his head. So Coco was fixed in the basement of a copper vest way back years ago. Now look what it is now. It's amazing, I really. I had a niece that 2 years ago was charged with remodeling headquarters of Coco downtown. And if you ride by my store, we just remodeled the supermarket this morning. You'll see a big, beautiful Coco sign on the side of the building. We just put up and painted. It's historic. And it on it says Crook Marketplace 1913. And the bottom it says visit historic store. So you see that as you come and drive by, you'll see that. But also, 1957 was the first frozen food sold in the snow. I bought a little 6 foot case. It had little dividers along in the case, a piece of aluminum fit over those dividers, and that's where the cold place we call them. And you put that in every few days, you had to take those aluminum covers off and get the ice off of them. One will sell to frosting back those days. I went to Atlanta, I went by Morrill Avenue and picked up hot ice, I call it, and I had a 2 fridge bags, laying flat on the trailer, and took the hot ice off the fridge bag. I went on out to my brother had a store out of East Atlanta, out there by East Atlanta Country Club, not far mid out there, and picked up frozen food in Atlanta and hauled back to Sonora. And some of the first frozen food was named Bird's Eye. Bird's Eye is still around somewhere, I think, now, sometime. Mm-hmm. Bird's Eye first frozen food hit Sonora, Georgia, years ago. But, and then I also put in the first air conditioner in Sonora, Georgia. I bought it from Emil's French Restaurant, Peachtree Street, secondhand, hauled snow and had installed. Put a blow in front of a plumb inside with a little air through. That was the first air conditioner Sonora, Georgia had in a store. All about how it was. Well, let me tell you about the air conditioned house. My wife had a little over a honeymoon cottage, I call it, a little bit of house. 4 little rooms, a little bit of hallway. And after I had been in the Army, this couple we had met, knew I was in there with, wrote my wife one day, says, they live in this nice air conditioned house, and so forth, so on. Then we was in a little bit of house there beside the road, that's small. I said, hey, we got it made. We got a fan set around his air conditioner both back and forth. We got air conditioner blowing each room. So that's all kind of air conditioner we had back then. But anyway, I lived long enough to that lead. They'd have got divorced down the road after that, children. So Pat and I did them all the way on that deal. Also, we had put in the first electric doors in Sonoma, Georgia, for a supermarket there. No, it's only electric doors I reckon in town I know of. Thank God we do have electric elevator downtown, but there we are. But I have a son named Greg Crook. He and I have been working together. He's 54 years old. He and I have been working together ever since he was born, you might say. I sent him to Auburn University to school there, and Cheryl too. And my wife was gone, but the whole family was gone, except his poor boy. Anyway, he came back, he called me one day and wondered what major in. I said, son, don't hold me alive, I want to get a degree in finance. If I would, I would think so. And he did. And now he operates 4 corporations. We have a Crooks Incorporated, which is 2 supermarkets. Oh, by the way, I want you to be me in Newnan to go out and visit my store in Newnan and Crooks. There's food outlet on the west side of town. 3rd largest store of wine in Cayuga County. Oh, a hell of a selection of wine. top-notch meat market there. We got a whole meat case with nothing in it but chicken. We package all our chicken, 90% of chicken right there in the store. Two reasons, you get it fresh and cheaper. Now, I had to do this advertising now, because y'all not paying me. I had to get an advertising here tonight, somebody. Anyway, go by and check it out with me. Make it over. We're proud of it. But anyway, we have two finance officers. We have one finance officer in Snow, and one in Union City, Georgia. Then we have Crook Super Corporation, which is AB Tire Sunday, AB Gas Station. Then my son has an insurance agent called Crook South Insurance Agent. They've been in our office building called Eddie Office Building, named for my mother, and right up the street by the Tire Sunday. So we want to fast a bit, but I started borrowing money when I was 18 years old, and I ain't quit yet. Still, I don't know how to borrow money. But anyway, see when that other store is along the line.
Tell them about the teen club.
Oh yeah, teen club. I'm glad I brought her along.
Elaine used to go, right?
Yeah, Elaine, okay. Elaine probably tell you about my teen club. Anyway, I bought American Legion. My brother was Secretary Treasurer of Snow Veterans Incorporated. After World War II, the veterans decided to build a building down in the park there. I mean, they bought the land, right where the state had a swimming pool years ago. They bought the land. They want to build a clubhouse there. They all signed pledges like people at church do sometimes, like pledges. That each one's going to pay so much a month towards the office, towards the building. Well, I tell you what, you know what happens. People pledge, you know what happens. Well, the pledges start thinning out, and the payments start going down. So one night we had a blood meeting there in the building. And old man Paul McKnight, there was Carl McKnight, young Carl McKnight's uncle. And Carl McKnight's, you know, his daddy is 60-something years old. That was his uncle, his daddy.
Grandfather.
His grandfather. His grandfather, anyway, he said to me that night, he was a veteran. The boys, if you'll, I'll match the money y'all get up to pay off his balloon note. His balloon note was held by the Federal Savings Loan here in Canyon County. So I matched it. So we started having cheese, barbecue, and everything trying to pay off that balloon note. And meanwhile, we still had that regular note looking at us in the face. So I came with an idea of teen club. And I started booking bands, teenage bands now, on Saturday night. I left my wife and two, three children home by several Saturday. I caught hell for that a lot of times too, doing that. Because she left by several Saturday night. Go down and police that operation. And we had a time, the teenagers had a hell of a good time. They had hired something like 200 or 300 down on Saturday night. They dancing to the teenage band. I charged $1 apiece to get in. And half of that money went to pay the note off, and the other half went to the band, pay the band. And so that's a legacy I never let down, because I still got people like laying right here. I got one girl down at Brooks Jordan named Diane. She come out and say regularly, every time she said, I never got my team club. But I still people come out my team club. They had a hell of a good time. And I kind of figured why to stop. They won't wait the fact about the note paid off or the fact that it won't come integration or somehow it stopped it along some way somewhere. But that was a wonderful time in Sonoma, Georgia. And also we had a state park. A guy named Freeman Sasson, he was an alcoholic. He came to Methodist Church one night, highly inebriated, me and his club meeting. But that sucker straightened up. And when he straightened up, he became a great sister. I mean, a great sister. He not only straightened up, he became mayor of Sonoma, Georgia. He got the state of Georgia come down and set himself a state park. Built a swimming pool. I mean, there was something. We used to have beauty contests around a swimming pool. And in my book, you see one picture of those girls standing around the swimming pool in the book, right there. They had a good time at that park swimming. And that's where my son learned how to swim. But the way they got my son ready to swim, they took some pins down in the pool. He dived down. He learned how to dive down and get those pins on the bottom of the pool. But anyway, they had a great time. And for years, they was around that pool in Snow, Georgia. But Teen Club was one of the things that I do hold in regard to having it been a great time to Snow, Georgia. But anyway, we'll move on now and see what else here. The oh yeah. In 1980, my wife inherited a chunk of money back from one of my uncles. Set up in a unit in the Federal Savings Bank. And I went, oh, Larry Strickler was president of the Federal Savings Bank. Did y'all know Larry Strickler? Yeah, well, then y'all know. Anyway, he told me when I got ready to build a supermarket, come on up there. Well, I let the contractor, that's something to know, you know what this is, really good lesson. I let the contractor build a supermarket on faith of what he told me he was going to do. But I started building a supermarket with no money to finish it, nothing to put inside, no money to put anything inside. When I went up there to get the money, he sent me everywhere in the world. He didn't have the money, he sent me everybody. Farm Home Administration, Small Business Association, everything. And I was about to drown everything I lose, everything I own. But I happened to look at Southern California Hospital Authority. And Harold Hammond was president of the bank here in town. And Charlie Martin was a lawyer, county lawyer in town. And Charlie said, let's see if we can figure out how to get along with Coweta County Development Corporation. And Charlie drew up the papers, become a full-time. Went to bond attorney amount, paid full-time, set to probably make the bond. Then I had to get somebody to buy to get the money. Well, Harold Hammond, the brother of the bank, had a son. He is called a financial advisor. He wanted a financial advisor to get for some time, you know. I put $8,000 in that financial advisor's pocket. His dad is sent it to him. So I get a loan at the bank. So I paid $16,000 just to get a loan of $475,000 to get that supermarket built. He told me I sweat blood and tears a long time, for years trying to get the thing paid off. That's a good example. But when you go deal with a banker, everything right, be sure he's an officer bank when he signs the contract, when he signs the paper too. Because you don't want nobody backing out on him. You want to make sure everything works. By the way, Jimmy Carter, president on then, interest rate went to 21%. I mean 21%. And the County Development Authority was getting tax exempt. They were only paying I got the interest at 10.5%. Because there's tax exempt interest on this loan to the bank. So that's a good example of the financing you get hooked up. I've sweat a lot of bullets trying to borrow money. But it's challenging sometimes. It's very challenging. Just a lesson to you, though. Anyway, when we got that building at the park burned off, we paid for it at the Veterans Club. At the Veterans Club, we paid off. Well, took a panel, a little past there, and I put that on the panel, let some light to it, burnt that note. That was a joyous celebration. They had played out of the way. But anyway, the time goes along. Most all your veterans have died. Few of us left around that. I got the few left to agree to give the park and the property and the building to the city of Sonoma. With stipulations, of course. So the city of Sonoma got that building and the land with a stipulation that any veteran on the record at that time could use that building one day a year free of charge. And if they don't want to start up again, they can use two times a month free rent. And they've done one, but they, and also the fact they had to remodel it, put in something to eat, something to laugh. And at that time, the mayor was less than a man, he got a wonderful job. So that's one city, the way the city's got one of the parks at. Oh, let me tell you about another thing. When you come in town from Newnan, you see the big lakes on the left, y'all. On the left. That's called Merrimack Lakes back in the day. It's called Merrimack Lakes, named for Miss Merrimack Knight. Her husband, Mr. Carl was her husband. He's the one who built that. And the way they built it was they took two mules pulling a snake scoop. And Doug and I were scooping. Mules were pulling scoops back then. And you got tracks to do everything now. Anyway, also, you'll go out and look at the lodge back out on the back of the lake. You see, it's huge, looking big piece of stone built out of. They came out of what we call a duck mill. Duck mill was built during World War I to make clothing for soldiers, make what we call duck clothing, they call it. Ended up opening up. It got set up, never actually worn in, I think, and it fell through. That's where the rock came from to build Merrimack Lakes now. did a lodge like that way back years ago. That's another story about down slower. Oh yeah, you're reading a book about this guy called Doc Tennyson. He had, took a Franklin engine and put it on the back of an A-model frame. Had a wood box up front you sit in and steer right behind that wood box with steering wheel. The propeller attached to that Franklin engine that pushed the vehicle along the road. No cage around it now, just a pedal back of wood. He goes up through some old dirt streets back then, whirling that blowing dust everywhere. This old man named Miss Saxon had a millinery shop up there. Miss Sax stuck a head out the door to see what's going on, and that propeller blew the wig off her head. And everybody in the market, Miss Sax was wearing a wig. That was a town talk for a long time. Another day, another story you're going to have to tell you, this day I'm going to tell you, I'm going to give you nothing. It entice you thinking. There were two men, one named Doc Ten and one named C.H. Cleveland, about a diamond ring and a mule. Now you're going to wonder what a diamond ring and a mule is. You ain't going to tell, I ain't going to tell you to read a book. Diamond ring and a mule, put that together.
It's a good story.
Good story.
It's a good story.
That's a good story, a diamond ring and a mule. But anyway, that was a long time ago also. But also, I was in a Troop 49 Boy Scouts when I was 13, 14, 15, something along in that. We didn't have a very good scout leader back there in those days. But a guy named Billy Hancock came on several years later, and recharted Troop 49 of Savannah, Georgia. And he didn't have a boy at all, he had one girl. And he did a fantastic job of looking after the Troop 49. I have donated, they go out for camping trips, so forth. Along come these other guys, we had one black man joining the troop with Billy named Virgil Brooks. Now Virgil was one of the top notch guys you'll ever see. I mean, A1. He had two nephews and all made it through Eagle Scouts. And another guy was Glenn, he was an electrician named Glenn. Older guy, worked with Billy, and they did a fantastic job of really teaching real scouting in Savannah, Georgia, about 349. But anyway, and so Billy died a few years back, and here, and I donated to the Boy Scout troop, I believe that 100%. And I pictured the book of me at the church, all getting a plaque for my service to Boy Scouts. But anyway, along comes this disaster now. They merged Girl Scouts and Boy Scouts. And when they did that, I looked at Virgil, black man, looked at Virgil, time to get out. You put your hand in the wrong place, right, somebody that accused you or something. And that was the demise of Troop 49 Savannah, Georgia. I hate to see it, really. But it's amazing what modern day things you think are great, they cause problems sometimes, a lot of problems. But these men donate hours and hours and hours on these boys. And taught them to be good Eagle Scouts. I'm not just Crook, of course. They taught me the real facts of Boy Scouts. How to camp, how to tie ropes, the whole thing about Boy Scouts. And that happened last year sometime. Methodist Church was sponsoring Boy Scouts. But another thing. We had a high school in Snow until 1946. And it merged with Star High, Sharpsburg, Star High, they call it. It became East Canada High School. Anyway, they had the old building set there for a long time, the old high school building. Long about that time, we tried to get a mill in Snow to come there, to open up. And we had a little sewing operation there, but it didn't fail through. But we had Carter come that makes baby clothes. Online to come there and to start a small sewing operation and train people and they're going to build a plant. Well, lo and behold, $400 were given to buy the land to build the original school years ago. Each person gave $25 except two people. Two people got 12 and a half piece. It was a partnership between Coca-Cola, they had a Coca-Cola bottling plant there then, way there. They get 12 and a half piece. Well, Jimmy Hudson, Buddy Holberg, you heard of Holberg's phenomenon. But all of us, three of us got deeds with deeds of Sonoy, but both all of heirs to lead to the city, except one family, which that 12 had one family. And they called up Dean of Massachusetts when Carter Cummings was trying to come and told them that we'd take the old gymnasium, which was a disaster repair, and told them that what they'd take the gymnasium wouldn't show. So anyway, they counseled out. Next thing you knew, this house called fire one night. And I mean, they burned high. They had 4 degrees inside over the years. And here recently, I knew a teenager, we figured that out like quick. But anyway, we all figured out pretty well one of these sentence that didn't sound off. They had a sentence kid, we think, burnt that schoolhouse down. But anyway, it's amazing what can happen sometimes. That since that time, City of Snow is on the property. But that's one of the history of the old schoolhouse in Snow, Georgia.
So I'm going to ask a question that these people may want to hear. So how have you seen Sonoy? What is the biggest difference between Sonoy then and now?
Back in those days, we knew everybody. We charged grocery and delivered them way back. They think coming up that project now. Things up, Daddy, we did it. 1946, Frank's daddy and my brother went in this together. Delivered groceries and general store and everything else at the time. Back in the day, you knew everybody. We charged groceries, delivered them, and hoped the hell we'd get them to pay for them. We had time to get the money sometime. Things got so tight in 1973. I sent out letters to all these pilot wives and big wheels were using my money to go buy stuff somewhere else and ride me and not paying. So I saw that on February 1st, 1973. Someone will charge you 2% interest on all balance on money moment left on your account. Well, legally I might could have done, but I was going to threaten. So anyway, I got them, they quit charging. And I kept the blue collar man kept on going, charging. And I got all my money out of my accounts and I was able to survive. And so it's been some tough times along the road, but anyway, we deliver groceries, charge more than deliver groceries. Now you try to deliver groceries with a can of kerosene in the truck with you. Mm-hmm. And not a spout on. We take a potato, cut a potato, stick it down on top of that spout. You've been lost 1,000 times, the spout at the top. Put it on top of keep that kerosene slashing out on the grocery when you haul them home. On Saturday afternoon, these black people didn't have a car, now they walk into town, get a grocery, you haul them home in the van with the groceries. Take them home at night. You know, if you arrive on the store now in Snow, you'll see a big picture on the window. This black guy selling them pickup truck with credit with the name on it, A.L. Crook, 490 Snow, Georgia. That was back in early 50s, I believe the picture was made. Oh yeah, you know, our motto is get an honest deal with A.L. Crook. Now, my brother coined that. He was really a crook. His initial A, L, Crook. So he was really a crook. So the tie business we got, you just keep them, the tie business I might tell you, keep them rolling with a crook. Now in finance company, we're going to put a name on it. And so here we go. I'm about to shut up. We don't talk too much already. Is it 7:30? Long question over.
One more.
I was up here, Scottish people had that. And when your fanny gets tired, your mind quits. I don't want your fanny to get too tired.
One more. Tell them what Christmas was like in Sonoy when you were growing up.
Back in the fall of the year, the farmers, when they gathered the cotton, that's when the money flowed. When the picking cotton was brought to town, they had money the first time. They had money during the year, barn. So the farmers, the merchants were Holberg and Daniel, and Magnite. And Holberg and Daniel did a super job of enticing people to spend money with them. They give you tickets when you buy tickets for a drawing when you bought stuff from them. And they throw turkeys off the top of a building Yeah, that on Saturday. All this is not on Saturday. When the big event was on every Saturday.
Real turkeys?
Huh?
Real turkeys?
Yeah.
Live turkeys?
Yeah.
Okay.
Live turkeys. Anybody don't think about live turkey now, do they? Everything floating in it. Anyway, I also had a pole, a breeze pole. Everybody climbed that pole and win a prize, you know. They put all kinds of things to get people to come to town. Mm-hmm. And back in the Christmas time, on Christmas Eve, the merchant would take a showcase with all firecrackers and candy and all that, sit down on a sidewalk and have a high school student to operate that stuff and have a glass case on the sidewalk. And back in those days, you throw firecrackers any way you want to back in those days on the sidewalk. And you rode down the new wagon, you better put it way out back somewhere because they been running the views off firecrackers shooting much. Now, we know what modern city now. It's all different in the world. Too many rules, too many regulations. But here we go. Got to buy them. But I'll say this for the film industry in Samoa, Georgia has done wonderful for modernizing, putting money in people's pocket. And speaking of putting money in people's pocket, they just wrote me a check last week for $1,000 to use behind my store, not front now, in the back of the store. And when I got Crook Road between my property where I live. And they paid me money to park the equipment on my property, shit, run cars up and down the square road shooting film without any interruptions. But they closed up both ends of the short road. So that's the film end. But the only people against film is ones not get profited by it. Someone's raised the can about it. But anyway, it's really built town up. It's something. Go look at us and go down to Grandma, Georgia. You'll be proud of being small, Julie.
Did you ever know a monkey named Pete?
Huh?
Do you ever know a monkey named Pete?
A monkey. I had a monkey. I went to Doc Ten had a monkey, and monkey got loose, and monkey came over to my dad's property there. It was a big barn. There was a big lot behind the barn. The mules were in. At that time, the gypsies were. We call Irish horse traders. They from Augusta, Georgia, where the Southern Line found it. But the Irish horse traders travel around trading mules and horses to people. And the women have a two-wheel trailer that pull a tent on there. They go around selling linoleum. You better check in linoleum before you left, or you want a dime or 12, you wind up a six by nine. Anyway, that lot was full of mules. And that boy got over there, that lot started riding the mules back in the lot there. They finna bust the lot wide open. Get out of the mule. They had took a pistol and shot that monkey. He was like Doc's monkey that day. Say the mule getting out. Is that what you're talking about?
That's what I'm talking about.
All right. Enjoy. Y'all.